Well, howdy, howdy, howdy. I am glad to be here. Hope you are too. I've got Harley with Harley Dogs live with me right now. And I want to ask him some questions because this guy has impressed the crap out of me. He has a big family, 5 kids, wife. I don't know how many dogs, cats, chickens, and possums he's got, but he's in Kentucky, so he's probably got a few. And I want to ask him some questions and share his experience with this. So welcome, Harley, and thank you for being here.
Hey, no problem, Ben. Thanks for having me.
I'm excited to do this, and I know we've talked, but I am impressed with you, and I'm impressed with everything you've done and your reasons behind it, but I want to share it with the world. I want people to know. So do you care to start off with why hot dogs? Was it always a lifelong childhood dream since you were 3 1/2 and your dad got you a Lego hot dog cart or something? What created this, brother?
Get the Oscar Mayer wiener toy, the whistle.
Exactly.
That's what did it, man. That's what it was. No, so I'll tell you a little bit about me. And it's just, so I come from a poor background, you know. I come from a big family, 8 kids. So I'm one of 8 siblings. And just working dead-end jobs, man, mostly restaurants. I've been in kitchens most of my life, and I always wanted to own a restaurant, but never really seen the possibility of that happening, you know. And just, you know, I don't know. That's my background somewhat. And 2011, I got saved at my church and started having a bunch of babies a little bit before then, actually. and started to realize there's no way I'm going to raise these kids on a $10 an hour salary. And so I just started praying about, you know, Lord, what am I going to do? He just said, save your money. So instead of taking my tax return income and buying a new car or wasting it on this or that, I just kept saving my money for a couple of years. And honestly, here's the strange part. Had a dream sometime in 2012 of me outside being a hot dog cart vendor. I don't know why I had that dream, but I woke up and I told my wife, I think we're going to get in the hot dog business. And she looked at me and was like, huh? Yeah, what are you talking about? And then from then on, that's where the journey started. I started trying to find what I could. Now, I don't even think we had a smartphone at that time, but I eventually found you and just started watching everything I could watch that you had there. I was on your website watching, you know, just how to even set up a cart. You had a lot of stuff then, you know. You got a lot more now, but for a person who knew nothing, absolutely nothing about it, you were the person to go to as far as I was concerned, because that was the only place I could really find any information about it. And then just watching your videos over and over and reading everything that you had posted, and the fact that you had a book called Hot Dog Saved My Life, I thought, wow, that sounds interesting. You know what I mean? Like, right. This guy's dead serious about this. And so then I finally pulled the trigger and bought the cash cow, and that was in 2013, and here we are now.
Dang. So 11 and a half years ago.
Yeah.
All right. So you know this. You've been doing this long enough. You know there's the good, bad, and ugly of vending.
Oh, yeah.
Do you mind sharing some of the challenges you faced in the beginning, getting started, and what you did about it? Were there any major hurdles you had?
I'll tell you the biggest hurdle, and it's not just me, it's with people who I've seen ask me throughout the years, what do I got to do this? You know, what steps do I need to take? And what I've learned, and what I learned from myself, and what I've learned from people who I've given advice to, who I've seen do it and not do it. The biggest hurdle is do it, you know, just do it. That's literally the hardest part, I believe, for any, not just this business, any, you got to do it. You have to take a chance on yourself. You got to, you know, at some point. That was the biggest problem. Now, doing it is one thing. Now, once you get to doing it, then you get, my biggest issue was when I first went and talked to my local city about it, the answer was no. No, we don't allow hot dog vending. We don't allow mobile food vendors on our sidewalks. I wanted to be outside the courthouse. That was, for my city, that was the most foot traffic as a business district. And I figured anywhere outside of that, it just wasn't worth it, you know? I mean, because at this point, I wasn't even considering doing private events or, you know, catering, none of that. It was just, I wanted to be what you see in New York, a hot dog vendor on the corner, you know? That was my idea. And the first answer was no. And so I remember watching your videos and you saying things like, you might hear a no, but don't let that stop you, because there's ways around this. And I don't remember the exact wording because it was so long ago, but I actually went and got into the city codes and I found some old zoning maps where there were actual 9 pre-zone area zones for mobile food vendors, specifically hot dog vendors.
Holy cow.
And that was in their paperwork. So I brought that back to them, and one of the locations was where I want it to be. And she looks at it and she says, and this is just the lady at the front window. You know what I mean? I hadn't talked to anybody upstairs or behind the scene. She says, I never seen this before. I said, well, can you lead me to the person who might be able to help me with this? Because this says I can be out there, you know? And long story short, they finally got around to accepting the fact that there's going to be a hot dog vendor right there in downtown Covington, Kentucky. Yeah, because it's already written. So, you know, it was hard for them to deny it, you know? So they gave me a zoning permit to do it. Then just going, like, my ideal, I wanted to, this was another thing. My idea when I started this was I wanted to do Philly cheesesteaks. And I had a big menu in my head already. Didn't realize, well, the health department is going to have something to say about that. You know? So once I got through the health department, they were basically like, no, we can do this, 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 and this. And I'm like, okay, well, that's what we're going to do. We're going to do hot dogs, brats, and Mets, you know? And I'm allowed to do nachos and cheese, drinks, and chips. Looking back on it now, I'm kind of glad it happened that way, because what I've learned over the years is, who says that, Dave Ramsey? Keep it simple, stupid. You know, the simpler it is, I'm telling you. You don't consider that in the beginning. In the beginning, you think, man, I'm gonna cook the whole world. You know,
and
that's fine and well when you only got 2 or 3 people. Who's coming at a time, if you're lucky, you know, one at a time, you know, in the beginning, you can spend 20 minutes cooking a gourmet meal. That's fine.
Right.
But fast forward, you know, 5, 10, 11 years, and it's like you got 30 people who just showed up at the same time. You're glad you're only doing hot dogs, brats, and meds at that time. So, but that's another thing I tell people when they ask me, it's like, hey, just know what you want to do. And then find out what you can do. You know what I mean?
Right.
Try to be realistic. You know what I mean? Make sure you check with your local health department, you know, because they have a say in that.
So what do you love most about it, Harley? What is your most favorite thing? What has brought you the most joy from street food vending or vending in general? Period.
Well, the number one thing is, I think we discussed earlier is the freedom that you have with doing this. Like I told you before, when my kids leave for school in the morning, I'm home. When my kids get home from school in the afternoon, I'm home. Which means I work my little 4 to 5 hour window, you know, and that provides enough to raise my 5 kids. But more important than that, it allows me to be a dad. And I tell everybody that's my number one job. With 5 kids, 3 girls, and 2 boys, my number one job is to be a dad. And hot dogs have allowed me to be the dad that I wanted to be. And that's it. I mean, I can't say that there's anything more important. The money's great, you know. That buying a house is great. Being the first person in my family who's ever owned a home, that's all wonderful. The financial benefits
are
great.
Hold on. You passed over that pretty quick. I don't mean to interrupt you. I do mean to interrupt you. That was pretty impressive. You're the first person in your family to own a home?
Yes. Yes, I am.
Holy man.
And still to this time, the only person out of my brother, sisters, mom, dad, never owned a home. Yeah. We grew up renting, jumping house to house, you know, dirt poor, you know, we were government assistance, you know?
Yeah.
So, it's funny. when we first bought our home, my oldest brother, I brought him in to check out the house and everything. He takes me to the side. We're out on the back deck. He says, "Be honest with me. Are you selling drugs or something, man?" I said, "I'll be honest with you. I'm just selling hot dogs. I know it's hard to believe, but we're just selling hot dogs, man."
Now, we do put a little meth and fentanyl in the chili.
Yeah. Now, they are like crack because they make you come back, but it's not actually crack. You know, it's just hot dogs, you know. First person, I wish they would. And I've tried to bring family members into this business. It just, we come from a strange family, man. We broke a cycle. With me and my wife and we broke a cycle of poverty, a cycle of crime, a cycle of drug addiction, and we're outside of that. And so when you get outside of that, sometimes people look at you different. They look at you like you think you're better than they are.
Right.
And I've always told them, man, I'm not trying to be better than you. I'm trying to be better than the man I used to be. And that's it. You know, that's all I'm trying to ever be better than. The guy I was yesterday, you know? So,
holy cow. You're bringing tears to my eyes. Tasha's sitting here listening to this, and she's got tears rolling down her face on the stuff you're saying, because it has an impact. I grew up the same way. I have two children right now, adult children, on drugs, and it's the poor. It's the poor South. It's the mentality. It's the and so I can relate to family members and that stuff, and even crime and all that stuff. I am thankful that you're changing that cycle, breaking that cycle, and your children, holy cow, your children, five kids are getting to experience real, a dad that goes, you know what? I'm not being a part of this. I'm going to do this, and I'm going to take whatever beatings I have to, but you're going to have a dad and a mom, and you're going to be loved, and I'm going to be home in the morning and home in the evening. And
that's right.
There is nothing more valuable. In my opinion, there's nothing more valuable.
I agree 100%. 100%.
Holy cow.
And you know, and that's why, I don't mean to cut you off, but
no.
I've had a cash cow, like I said, for over 11 and a half years now, right? I could have wrote you at any point in time and said thanks, right? But you sent out that cash cow email about cutting prices back to 15 years ago, right?
Yep.
And I don't know what it was, but I saw that email and I thought, that ain't far from when I bought a cash cow 11 and a half years ago. And then I just got to thinking, sometimes you just start thinking back on, man, where were you 15 years ago?
Right.
And where are you now? And so I got to getting into that mind and I'm thinking, man, where I was 15 years ago, it's incredible where we are today. And it's somewhat unbelievable. And then I had to pause and say, you know, Ben had a part in that, man. That guy really pushed me. Like that was the final straw to broke the camel. It was the way you talked about things and the inspiring tone that you used and the persistence and the way you never came off as a guy who was trying to sell anything. Or a guy who was trying to get something out of some, you genuinely felt like you wanted to help people because you seen what this could do for you and you wanted them to experience the same thing. And I felt led. I just had to say thank you. And that's what it was. So like I said, I could have done that at any point, but that's the moment I felt led. Like,
well, I can tell you this. It was the perfect point. And I told you, I sent you a message when you did that. You sent that email a couple weeks ago, and I went, I hadn't heard from you in years. And then you sent that email, and it just changed everything. My whole day changed. Everything about my everything changed. And I know some of that is ego, and some of it's nice to hear, man, you don't even look 70. You know, it made my day. And I told Tasha, I said, I got this email today. I want to read it to you. And I read it to her. And that act of kindness went a long ways. And obviously, I want to make money. Okay? It is my business. Yeah. But I feel morally obligated. And I promise you, and I've told this before, I made more money selling hot dogs with my three carts, because I went to 22 carts and then said, that was stupid, and then dropped down to three. And with those three carts, I made more money in Sevier County, Tennessee, than I make today. And I do this because I love it, and it's why I wrote the book, and that's why the book looks like a third grader wrote it, because basically I have a third grade education. And so it is a, you know, piss poor everything, but it got the point across. And my goal was just to help as many people as I could. I've tried to get all my kids doing it, and I only have one doing it. Out of 10 freaking kids, I got one kid doing it. But
that shocks me.
what are you, we're all different, but the fact that I was able to raise my kids for those years, it gave them the encouragement to, cause some are entrepreneurs. They're just not doing vending. Right.
There you go. Yeah.
And so, but it gave them the mindset to know that, hey, these things are possible. I watched Dad go from, you know, way up here to on food stamps and government assistance, which he said he'd never do, because you're talking about a crushing blow when I had to go to food stamps and public assistance and helping the churches were helping pay my electric bill. And I was like, I got to do something. I got to figure something out. This, I don't like this. I am so thankful that those organizations or systems are in place to help people, but I don't ever want to be the one. I'd rather be helping support it. And I love that my taxes go to some of that. That doesn't bother me a bit. It produces people like you who said, I'm going to be an example for multiple generations. And your actions and your wife's actions and the sacrifices y'all have made over the last 11 and a half years are going to have ripple effects for eons that you won't even get around to see, but you've made a dent in humanity. And I'm proud of you, man. I am blown away, and I'm just thankful that you'd even do this and write me. I know I went on a long spin, but.
No, I appreciate you saying that. I really do, Ben. It means a lot. You're right, man. It's really all that we do as dads, as humans, period, is about the next generation. And they don't look at that right now and say, oh, my dad's a hot dog vendor, so he's setting me up for my future. But we know as fathers, it's like, you know, hopefully there's something we're doing that's going to stick with them. It's funny when my kids are working with me at the hot dog cart, they get questioned all the time. So I guess you're going to take over the business. And what I love more than anything is my 12-year-old daughter. She'll say, I'm not going to be no hot dog vendor. I got big plans with my life. And I'm like, you tell them, girl, that's great. You know, you don't have to be a hot dog vendor. Yep. If you're going to go on and do something better, I hope you do. You know, but the difference with that is that at 12 years old, when I was 12 years old, to be honest with you, I thought I'd be in prison when I was an adult. You know, I didn't see a bright future. And the fact that she sees a bright future means something's working, you know, and that's what really matters.
Holy cow. I never even put that together. The fact that you are giving them an experience that's different, they can be optimistic about their future instead of pessimistic and feeling like, man, this is the, you know, the rope I'm meant to carry. I'm probably going to be in prison and have 16 kids by the time I'm 12, you know, that kind of mentality. Because I've got family like that, I think we all do. Somewhere we all got family like that. But you're encouraging those people. You're showing them there's something on the other side if they're willing to put in the work and effort that you and your wife have put in. Y'all have put in the work. So, holy cow, man. So what do you see for the future? I want to ask you that, and I think that's my last question. I'm sure we're going to get lots of questions, but I want to know what you see, what your plans are in the future. What's your goals?
Well, right now, like I said, my number one job is being a dad. So people ask me all the time, it's like, why don't you expand? You're doing so well. And I'm like, listen, like I told you in the beginning, Ben, it's freedom right now to be a dad, to be home at the time, be here with my kids and help raise them, you know. What happens after that when they're grown? You know, who knows? We could just expand. We could, I mean, because there's the opportunity. I could have done it many times over now, had more and more carts, moved into a food truck. All of those are possibilities, you know. And those possibilities are there, and I'm not sure if that's what we'll do or not, to be honest with you. It's nice to know that those are options, you know.
You couldn't have given a better answer, because you stuck with the narrative. Your original goal is to be the best dad and husband you can be, and be home for them, and have the freedom. And you just said, right now, my forecast is to still do that, because that was my dream. And you've already fulfilled it, and you're still fulfilling it. So I can't imagine the people you're inspiring. It's like throwing, you know, I talk about throwing I heard a preacher say this years ago, and throwing a rock in a lake, and he goes, you can watch that ripple for a while, and then it just disappears. He goes, but way on the other side of that lake where you can't even see, he goes, there's still vibrations moving. That effect of you doing that is being felt all the way across that lake. And he gave the example as of when you do good, when you do make choices like you're making, where you've not let your ego get in between you and get 22 carts like me in the first year. You did it smart, and it's working for you, and you're happy, and you're successful as hell. Anybody six-figure income, successful. But I don't care if it's $50,000 a year you're making. If you're happy and you're providing and doing what you want, who wants more than that? I don't. I don't give a crap. It took me a long time to get to that point where you already got, and so it makes me envious, because I missed years. I missed years with my kids, my older kids. I missed years with them because I let my ego control. Oh, I'm going to be the best dad because I'm never going to be home, and I'm always going to be selling furniture, and I'm going to be the richest furniture dealer in Tennessee. And what a pile of crap.
And I'll just mail the check home.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It just wasn't worth it. You know, I am so impressed with you, and I'm so thankful that you came on here and were so freaking honest and heartfelt. I can't even explain it, brother. I wish I could do something for you.
You've done enough, man. No.
Well,
you've done enough, Ben. I appreciate you having me on here, and I appreciate the kind words, man. And I hope you're right. I hope anything I have said does inspire someone who was on the verge or on the edge or close or wasn't sure, or it's their first time even hearing about it, and just inspire someone to look into it, you know, because that's how I got in. I just started looking into it, you know. And then one thing led to another. And like I said, you were that final push. So that's why I had to say thanks, man.
Well, you couldn't have came at a better time. I appreciate you, and I appreciate the fact that your love for your family and fellow man, and that you're making changes. And out of hot dogs, and your daughter's to the point where probably no daughter before her has ever said, I wouldn't do hot dogs and own a house and cars and stuff. I want bigger things, Dad. And you've got the first daughter probably in the family that's ever said that saw something more, that has that optimism.
That's what it's about. Yeah. It's the fact that she sees what I do as a small thing, you know, she's going way bigger than what we did. Yeah. This is small potatoes, you know,
right.
And that's great. I don't take offense to that at all. I love it. You know what I mean?
I love it too. You just tell her Taco Bell started with a hot dog cart. The guy that started Taco Bell started with a freaking hot dog cart.
So, that's right. Yeah.
Brother, thank you so much for taking the time and being here. And, I hope you'll be able to answer some questions, because I may have to ask you some questions that people ask. But either way, thank you for taking the time away from your family to help other families.
Yeah, no problem, man. Thanks for having me. And whatever you need to ask me, I'm available, man. Like I said, in the evenings, I reach out to me. Yeah.
Thank you, brother.
Most of our stuff's at lunchtime. So.
All right. Well, good. Yeah. Thank you, brother.
All right. Talk to you later, man.